plugs in.
All right, by quick show of hands, how many people made it out to the first meeting? All right, another quick show of hands, how many people here have done some programming? Okay, how many people have done programming in Unity? All right. So what my part of the talk is going to be about is just kind of bringing everybody up to speed that haven't done any programming yet. And then we're going to talk about specifics of C#, which is the language that I'm going to show you how to program in that you're going to use in Unity. And then we're going to get into some of the more Unity specifics. So let's start off here. But I'm going to give a quick overview for the people that didn't make it out to the first meeting. What Unity is and what the editor, how to use the editor here. So up here in the top left corner, you're gonna have your scene view. Your current layout might not look exactly like mine, but everything is labeled in these tabs here. So the scene view here is how you're gonna edit the scene, edit the game by dragging things around and placing objects. Directly below that is something called the game view. So this is what your camera, which you can see here in my scene, will see. And when you hit the play button up at the top here, that will be what is the game. So you can actually play it within the editor. Over here, there's a hierarchy. This shows every game object, so every object within the current scene. Right now in mine, all I have is this main camera. And if you open up a project for the first time, a new project, that will be the only thing in your project too. So below that is a project panel. This is all the files in your project. If you opened up a new project for the first time, yours will be empty. And this is where you'll kind of put files as you need them. Over on the far right here, I have the inspector. So if you just go and click on the main camera, you'll see that it'll show all the different objects and components and settings that you can change on that camera. So we have things like transform, the actual camera itself, the GUI layer, flare layer, body layer, etc. So what we're going to do is we're going to jump into how to actually program for Unity. So what I want you to do is in the project panel here, this little create button. If you just click that, it'll come up and give you a whole list of different things you can create here. We just want to click on C#. You might notice that there's some other scripting languages in here, one being JavaScript and one being BootScript. JavaScript isn't quite like the standard JavaScript in the browser. It's heavily modified, so a lot of us refer to it as UnityScript because it is far enough away. A lot of people like programming in JavaScript. Some people find it more accessible, but what you'll end up finding is that C# is just so much more of a robust language that if you work with JavaScript for a while, you'll end up just going to C# anyway. So we're going to kind of cut out the middleman and just go right ahead to C#. If you click that, you'll notice in the project pane here, you'll have a new C# file there, and it'll be blue highlighted new behavior script. So we're going to name this is intro. So just type intro in there and hit enter. So now you have this little script file. So if you double click on it, it'll spin and take a moment, and it'll pull up MonoDeveloper. So this is the built-in editor for editing your scripts. You can actually use any editor that you would like, because it's not actually the editor that compiles the code, it's actually Unity that does that. I personally use Visual Studio because I like it a little bit better, but this works just great. So we're going to quickly go over what the basic template here is for a script. So at the very top, you don't have to worry too much about these technical things. I'm just going over them so they're not a complete mystery. So at the very top, you have a using statement. And it says using Unity Engine. So all using means is that I want this library included and being able to be accessible from this class. So Unity Engine is just the core framework of Unity itself. Another using one here is systems.collections for just dealing with collections. So you have access to that kind of stuff. And as you need more complicated things, you can just kind of add them on as using statements here. But initially, you won't have to touch that very much. So the next line here is public class intro colon mono behavior open curly bracket. So all this is saying is this is a class. This is a chunk of code. And this class is named intro. So what you always want to make sure is that this name here is the same name as the actual file you created itself. So intro.cs should have a class called intro. These are always automatically generated. Whenever you rename them, it automatically names them for you. So next we have colon, mono behavior. So what this is doing is this is saying that this class wants to extend mono behavior. So mono behavior is already a huge chunk of code, and this is just sitting on top of it. So just another layer on top. So extending mono behavior just gives us access to a whole bunch of things that are of type mono behavior. And the other thing to point out is anytime you want a component that's going to work with a game object, which I'll show you in a second, it needs to be of type mono behavior. So you have an open curly bracket here. And at the very bottom, you see we have a closing one, so everything that opens closes. Now inside here, we have two methods. And the first one here is void start, open round bracket, close round bracket, and then two open and close curly brackets. This is for, as you can see in the comment here, use this for initialization. So if you want any code to run right off the get-go, you want to put it in start. There's another method called awake that's even before that, but for general use, start is what you're going to need. And below it here is one called update. And as it says here, this is called every frame. So if you need something to be checked every frame or updated every frame, you'll put it in here. There's lots of other these special functions, that methods that will get called, but we're just going to focus on these two for right now. So to show kind of what you're doing programmatically, because we're not going to be interacting with anything within the game at this point, we're just going to want to trace out, print out a result of something. So to do that, what we're going to use is the debug log. So in the start here, if you just type debug, and you'll have this IntelliSense thing come down. If it is selecting the current item that you want, just hit tab, and we're going to go period, and it'll come up with a bunch of other things, and type log. Enter. And then we're going to pass something into the log. So open round bracket. And we're just going to pass in a piece of text. So we're going to type hi. So now let's go back to Unity here. And you'll notice, and it's pretty quick here, but in the bottom right corner there'll be this little spinning wheel. Every time you save something in here, yeah, make sure you save once you're done here. Every time you save something in an editor and you come back to Unity, it automatically goes and compiles those scripts and gets them ready to run for you. So now if you hit play, you'll notice nothing happens. That's because we need to attach this script to a game object for it to run. So let's go and create a game object. Up in the top bar here, we have a game object dropdown. Hit create empty. And it'll create a new game object here called game object. We're just going to go over here beside it in the inspector. And we're just going to call it code and hit enter. So once you've done that, just click on that intro script and just drag it all the way up. And it'll highlight around code with a blue. And you're going to release it. So now if we click on that thing, that game object code that we created, you'll notice that it is a transform, which all game objects do, but below it, it'll say intro script. So this means the script is going to run. So now, once you've done that, hit the play button. So you'll notice here, in the very bottom left-hand side here, there's this little bubble with an exclamation mark in it. It'll say hi beside it. So that is our log. You'll use this a lot for testing and kind of seeing what's going on in your code. So, and if you also want to see it in a bigger screen, just double click on it, or single click on it, sorry, and it'll pull up this window here. But I want you to make sure, because I don't know what the default setting is, there's this little clear on play button. Just make sure it's clicked, so it's highlighted. That way, every time you hit the play button, it just clears the log for you. So if you want to trace things between two different sessions, you don't get mixed up which was in one and which was in another. So let's unclick play here, and let's go back. theater.
Did everyone manage to run that, or did anyone have any like weird errors or anything?
Yeah, I'm getting a weird compiler error.
What's the compiler?
I'm not sure. When I try to drag the game object or drag the intro thing, the script onto the code object,
yep.
So it says I need to pixel compiler errors.
So maybe Devin didn't want to simulate an error.
Yep.
Just to show how you like debug.
That's a good point here. So what I'm going to do is, you don't have to do this, but I'm going to remove the component off this game object and show you what will happen if you have an error here. So say I typed, putting that in there, which is clearly not a thing. So when I go here, it's going to come up, and at the very bottom, right where we had that debug log, this is also your error log. So if we click it, it'll come up here and say assets intro, and it'll try to say, okay, there's something, I don't know what a log is.
Oh, case sensitive.
So if you ever try attaching a script that has an error in it, it'll give you another error.
Or not.
Sometimes it does. Sometimes it says you can't do it because it can't compile successfully.
Probably what it's doing is using the previous
version of it.
One that was successful, but yeah. You can double-click, I guess, on that.
Yeah, so say I wanted to find this error easily. You just double-click on it. And what it'll do is launch, and it'll highlight the line that it's on, which is awesome. So then I'm like, oh yeah, it's not a log, it's log.
Log.
Clearly. All right, let's go back to where we were.
Yeah, they're going to add a log in 3.6.
Okay, so now we're going to go back to the editor here. What we're going to do is I'm going to give you a brief intro to variables in C# here. So a variable is just a object of a certain type. So the first one we're going to deal with is an int. So an int stands for integer. It's just a number without a decimal place. So we're going to go int, and we're going to name that int num. Now we want num to have a value of something. So we're going to go equal sign, and I want it to have the value of 1. Semicolon. So all the lines, just make sure every statement ends in a semicolon. All right, so now if in that debug log we get rid of that high, and we just type num, we're going to pass into log the value of num. So now if you go back here, hit play, you'll see it prints out 1.
Did anyone have errors with that one?
No, I'm good. Fortunately, numbers are not case sensitive.
All right, so now let's do something with that num. So we're gonna do some basic math here. So I'm gonna go, I wanna add 2 to the value of num. So if I just go num equals the value of num plus 2. So that's going to print out 3. All right. So simple enough. So now I'm going to show you some of the other variables that you're going to be using a lot. So the next one is float, which stands for floating point number. So this is a number that does have a decimal place. So we're going to set it to the value, I'm going to call it val, and we're going to set it to the value 2.2. So one would think that you could just do this, and that makes sense. In C#, with floating points, they're kind of special. You need to actually specify that it is a floating point, but there's a shortcut for that. If we just put f at the end. So whenever you're dealing with a float, and it's a decimal something, just make sure you put an f at the end. That kind of casts it as a float, so everything will be good.
It sounds crazy right now, but you'll get used to it.
Yeah. It's real.
Kind of like taxes. And
Okay, so the next one we're going to talk about is bool. It stands for boolean, which is a true or false. So I'm going to say bool, and I'm going to call it is on, and I'm going to set it equal to false. And the last one is going to be a string. So we kind of did this already with what the high was. The high we wrote in there in double quotes was a string. So we're going to call the string text, And we're set it to hello world.
Classic. Exactly.
So in start, what we're gonna do is we're just gonna print out what the results of these are. And we're gonna do this on a couple lines. So if we go debug.log, and now instead of just putting num into it, we wanna know what num is. So what you can do is we can concatenate a string and a string, or in this case, a string and a num. So by doing that, what you just do is go double quotes, num, and then we do the plus sign. So when you're dealing with strings, if you put a plus in there, what it does instead is it sticks things together. So it'll stick strings together, or in this case, it'll stick a num there. So what this does is it adds num, not physically like an addition, but as in concatenates, num with this. And we're just gonna rinse and repeat for the other ones.
The really cool thing is after Devin's done, he's gonna release this game on Steam that's gonna sell like really copies.
Yeah, so don't steal his code.
Yeah. It's an avant-garde art game about variable types.
It's gonna be huge.
So once you have that done, switch over here and hit play. And you'll notice here in the bottom left, all it says is text hello world. That's because this line only displays the very last item that's been printed out. So click on it, and you'll notice that there's now four items. Did everybody manage to get that?
Can you go back to the monotone stream? Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, if you guys are stuck on anything or you're behind, don't be ashamed to let us know.
Yes.
Do you need to attach that intro to something to get it to the
process? Yeah, so just make sure, sorry, I have to go that way. Make sure that we the code game object we created has that script attached. So if you click on code, if it's not attached, just make sure you drag that intro script up on top of code.
You can also drag it on twice, which means it'll run twice.
Yeah, let's do that.
Which will be weird.
And that's you got it. Oh, I gotta unplay it. There we go. Yeah, if you ever change anything while it's in play mode, the moment you unplay it, it undoes it. So yeah. Just something to be aware of. It's awesome for playing around with things, not so awesome when you don't realize play mode's on it. You've done it.
Made your entire level.
Yeah, and then you're like, okay, so now when I play that, you can see it duplicates. It runs it twice.
Can you bring the modern development thing back up?
Yeah. So if you ever have a component here attached and you want to get rid of it, just click this little drop down here and just go remove the component.
Sorry, can you read that code object? What type of object is that?
The which one?
That code
object? It's just a game object. If you need to create one, just go up to game object and create empty game
there
object.
You go. And I was missing a semicolon.
There's a couple chairs. So everybody got that?
I have a question.
Yep.
Okay, so how come the one that's in quotes is able to be capitalized? Is that just because that's just the string that it's printing out? Because that's not referencing.
Which line? This line?
No. The first. Yeah.
The purple text.
So that's able to be capitalized because it's not actually referencing the num variable, right?
Yeah. This is just a string. This is just a piece of text.
Yeah, it could be Bob.
It could be Bob.
But nothing else.
Just Bob. But yeah, that's just what we're going to print out.
That makes sense.
On that point, I should bring up, say you want to put a comment here. Say you would not understand what this does. You'll notice right above here, there is already a comment. Just do two backslashes here and just type, this prints stuff. And you're like, yay, now I get it. So yeah, that's an easy way to just do comments. Or what I use a lot is to comment things out. Say I'm like, oh, I want this debug log later, but I don't want it now. You can just do that. And then what it'll do is it won't execute this line of code. It'll turn, you see it turns it green here. Another way to do it is say I want to comment out a whole bunch of stuff, and backslash star, and then I close it by star backslash, the exact opposite. And now this here is a comment. It won't run and then type in stuff here.
So sometimes you might be trying like two different ways of doing the same thing. You can kind of comment out one group of code and see what this one does, kind of bound up, you know,
yeah,
try stuff out that way without having to delete it.
Yeah. Makes going back easier than sometimes using source control or something like that. So now we're going to show a really cool feature in Unity here. Up at this top, in front of this int, what we're going to type here is public. So you see that there's also public class. Public class just means that this class is available to everything. And so now what we're saying by public int is we're saying anybody who has access to this class, this intro class, can see and edit and change none. So let's just do that for all these variables. And we'll go back here and run this. And now select that code game object.
What just happened?
What just happened? Craziness just happened here.
Oh my God.
So what you'll see here is where there was just before intro script and then it said script intro, you now have a num, a val, an is on, and a text. So not only is this displaying this here, you can actually change it. So we're going to type, I'm going to say num7, this is 33.4.
Oh, you rebel.
I know, without a cause. So we're going to set is on to checked, which is true, and we're going to change this to my name is Devin. All right. Oops, and I did this with play, as to be expected.
Oh, no.
It's all ruined.
Somebody should pick a plugin unless you save those.
Yeah, somebody should pick a plugin.
What would that plugin be called?
I don't know. Something like play mode persist.
Play mode persist?
I don't know. That's what I would name it.
Oh, yeah.
If I hypothetically make that script that may or may not be available in the Unity asset store. Okay, so now that you've changed that, if you hit play, you'll notice if you click up, if you click this and move up the console, you'll notice that now it says 7, which is num is 7, value is 34, is on is true, and text is this. So what this is doing is something in the background. So why in our code here we said num is 1, and but we've changed it in the editor. So when you hit play, what it does is it overwrites those values to this. And this is extremely useful for doing things like editing your script, editing your game object's behavior on the fly, just in the editor, or making a script that does multiple different things. You don't have to hard code things. Did everybody manage to get that? Yep.
I noticed it didn't change the code. Is that something you'd want to do after you have the values?
So, like, would you want to change them? Yeah. So that is something, it depends. I'm sure you, say you like, do you want that num? I always want it to be one, right? You have some options. You can get rid of the public, or you can set it to private, or you can protect it. And then when you pull up the editor here, you'll notice num goes away, and num will have the value of one. So you can hide things. Just sometimes it's helpful to be able to edit them on the fly. And you can also set them to nothing, right? So say I'm like that num, I'm like, I don't have a value. So then I'm looking in code, I know that I'm going to be setting that in the editor. And when you fire up the editor here, am I playing again?
Yeah. Okay. Sorry, like what I mean is there some sort of invisible constructor that passes these values?
Yeah. So yeah, at runtime, it goes and fires those guys in there.
Then, you said you could use it in more than one place. Does that mean you could attach that same script to multiple objects and change the value in the editor on each individual object?
Yes, and that's the power of that. And I'll show an example here shortly of how to do that and how to utilize that. All right. So let's go back to the code here. Did everybody get that to work? Perfect. So let's go back here to start, and we're just gonna clean up all that code there.
Oh,
I want to clean
all that. So now we're gonna move on to the update method here. So what we're gonna do is we're just gonna print out something. So type debug.log, and we're gonna print out none again. But what we're gonna do is in this update, we're gonna go none plus plus. So what plus plus does is the same thing as none equals none plus one. It's kind of a shortcut. So plus plus is just that number equals itself plus one. Or minus minus would be itself minus one. So now if you give that a run, you'll notice here, if we open this up, it's going bananas here. And so you can see these numbers are incrementing by one. So that update statement is running every frame and printing out num plus one.
Pretty sick frame rate on
that. This is awesome.
Yeah.
All right.
Then you check Twitter.
And then I check Twitter.
You have to do that every so often, yeah.
It's very important.
All right. Thanks for going for that.
That's coming. So now what we're going to do is we're going to move on to conditional statements. And we're just going to remove that out of your update so that every time you play it doesn't print out a whole bunch of stuff here. So controlling the flow of code is very important to actually making it do something useful. So in the start here, what we're going to do is we're going to type if is on. So with two round brackets surrounding that, open curly bracket, close curly bracket. So what an if statement does is it evaluates what's in between those two round brackets, and it evaluates it. If it's true, any code between those two open and close curly brackets will execute. If not, it won't. So in is on, we're just going to go debug.log party. So now, if we wanted the opposite to happen, we can go else, which just means if the if statement doesn't work, go into the else. You don't need an else. In this case, I want one. Debug.log. No party.
No party.
All right. So let's give that a run.
They're either sad or indifferent, but never happy.
Never happy. Okay. Okay, so if you have is on checked, you hit play, it says party. We uncheck it. There's no party. All right.
Everyone caught up to that?
Can you bring up the pan again?
Yep. I need two screens.
So you can kind of see what those curly brackets are for now. They're for grouping code, basically.
So we don't just have to use things like Booleans, true or falses for those. It'll evaluate anything. So let's change is on to num is greater than or equal to 100. So what this says is it evaluates it to either true or false. So if num is greater or equal to 100, it's true. If not, it's false. Just go back here, hit play. My num is 7 right now, there's no party.
Reminds me of high school.
It's no party.
You're not invited unless your num is greater
than 120, there's one. All right. So you can also do complex, more complex things in here. So let's say we want, num has to be greater than 100, or val needs to be less than 10. So these double lines here, all they represent is or. So it means if one or the other. So this means if number is greater than or equal to 100, it's true, therefore it moves into here. If not, go over here, go is val less than 10, then still go into here. So as you notice, we go here, set our num to something like 8, so it won't run, and our val now less than 7. And we apply, and we have a part.
These parties are getting more and more difficult to
every
stage. It's, yeah, it's
so many rules.
Yeah. Can't hang with this clean anymore.
So the other, the opposite, not quite the opposite, but anyway, and is two ampersands. So that means they both have to be true. So we put ands in there. And now if we hit play, it won't go because we don't have, them both aren't true. So we want val, I forget what actually it is. Val has to be less than 10, num has to be. So say num's 100, we play, and we party. So just like math, what we can do is we could group these things. So let's say we're gonna have an open round bracket, and we're gonna group those statements. So just like in math, whatever is in the brackets we'll evaluate first. And then over here we're gonna go this or text equals Bob. So whenever you wanna make sure, see if something is exactly equal to, you wanna use the double equals, not the singles. Because the singles, as you can see up at the top here, the singles are used to set something. So we don't want to set text equal to Bob, we just want to check if it's equal to Bob. So if we go back here, set val is 10. So if we set val to 10, you'll see that this part will fail because val is greater than 10. So now I want to see if Bob is equal to, the text is equal to Bob, sir. So we hit play, we'll get no party. Sad face. And then in the text here, if we type Bob in the exact same case and hit play, we hit party. Okay, we're done with party to party now.
They didn't last very long.
I know, they never do. Oh no, I lied. I think we're gonna do one more. So the other thing we can do in here is we can go else if. So what we're gonna do here is, if it's this, do this. If not, evaluate this. And then at the end, if none of those are true, then go into else. So we're just gonna go else, let's go is on. House.
House party.
House party. That will not actually print house party. That was just the first word that popped into my head. So if we go here,
party with house,
and we change this to apple, this will be no party. But now if we hit is on, it'll be house. All right. So now we're actually done with this. Did everybody get that? Have any problems?
Chris says yes.
Chris says yes.
Computer
says no.
Computer says no. Okay, I have an issue where, hold on, let me talk. Okay. Just leave that up for a second. Let's make it figure it out. I just see the steam coming out of the top of my head.
I guess one of the things that's kind of complicated about this is the way it evaluates everything. Like the num greater or equal to 100 is going to evaluate as one thing. It's going to get turned into a true or false value, essentially. And then the val less than 10 is going to evaluate. And then the and is going to evaluate. This is a very sort of complicated example. This is like the simplest possible example, right?
But. So yeah, the easiest way is just to imagine what the result would be. So in this case, say val was less than 10, this would just evaluate to the word true, or to the value of true, and say num was equal or greater than 10, this would be true. So in an and, if there's two trues, this evaluates to true, and then you know that this is success, because in an or, all you need is one or the other. If this was false, then this would have to evaluate. And if it was Bob, then this would be true. And in an OR, only one of them has to be. So then this whole thing evaluates the truth. So that's just how it breaks down.
And in an actual game, what you would probably be using that for is stuff like input, like, oh, if this jump button is down, then do the stuff you need to do to jump. And sometimes it does get that complicated where it's like a game where there's a bunch of conditions at the same time. Like, if you're jumping but you're not on the ground, then don't actually jump because you can only jump if you're on the ground. So.
Yeah, and one thing I should mention is you don't just have to have them at this level. You can actually wrap anything inside this. So I could put an if statement, text equals high, and wrap this whole thing in that. And you can do this many levels deep. So it's just, if this is true, then go in here, then do this stuff. All right. So what we're going to do is we're just going to clean this whole all up here. So just go and clear that entire start statement. So now we're going to talk about looping. So here we're going to create a for loop. So a for loop is the loop that you'll be using the most. So this line may look just a little bit complicated, but I'll just go through it. It's not too bad. So we're for, and we're going to open round bracket, and we're going to go int. So we're going to create an integer, and we're going to call it n, just because I'm calling it n. And we're going to set it equal to 0. And then we're going to have a semicolon. As you've seen before, every time you have a semicolon, it's a new line. You don't have to put new lines. It's good practice to, but in a for, we're going to have multiple statements in a row ending in a semicolon. So then the next thing we're going to do is n is less than 5, semicolon, n plus plus. So as I said before, plus plus is just adding 1 to the value of n. So just like an if statement, we're going to have an open curly, close curly. This means that everything that's going to happen in this loop is going to happen in here. So we're going to debug dot log, and we're going to print the value of n. So now when we run this, okay, see here? What it prints out is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So the reason for this, n at the very start is going to be set to 0. Every time we loop through here, it's just going to check, is the value of n currently less than 5? If it is, do this, what's in here, and then add 1 to n. So the first time through it printed 0, because it came in here, 0 is less than 5, do this. So it printed out 0, and now we're going to add 1 to 0, sorry, 1 to 0, we're going to make 1. So then we rinse and repeat. 1 is less than 5, correct, go in here, print 1, and then it just repeats like that. Did everybody follow that? Have any questions? So we're going to talk about another type of loop. There's some cases that this loop works well. I generally avoid it because I make errors with it. It's called a while loop. And it's actually a little bit simpler than that loop. But it lends itself to infinite loops. I'll explain what that is in a second here. So we're going to create an integer, and we're going to call it p. And we're going to type while p is less than 5. So this while looks a lot like the if did. It's just evaluating what's in those brackets. So in here, we're going to go debug.log p, p plus plus.
Yes.
Yes, but only in this case.
You have greater than or equal to 5 people at the party and stops. It's too much party.
We don't have an overload. All right, so now let's go here. And we play that. And you'll notice that it printed the exact same thing as before. That's because This is doing the exact same thing as that for loop. So what is happening is I created this variable called pset to zero, and the while loop, all it does is just check. Is this true or not? If it's true, run this code, go back up to the top. And so instead I just put the P++, which is the same as that N++ before, inside here, right after this. So this is does the exact same thing. Now, while has its uses, the problem is that, don't try this, because it'll crash Unity. But if you accidentally forgot this line, what would happen is it goes into this loop and it prints out zero, and then it goes back up the top and it's like, oh, zero less than five, zero. And it does this forever. And Unity doesn't actually have a mechanism to break itself out, so it actually locks the editor and you have to control delete out of it. So that's why it's, because you, yeah, generally with a four, you won't fall into that trap. That's why it's just generally best to use a four. But there's some instances where you're doing really complex stuff that occasionally something is true that you're gonna wanna use a while.
Quick question.
Yes.
Okay, so you're defining the variable in like P within this sort of section here.
Yeah.
Is there any advantage or disadvantage to doing that as opposed to doing it up at the top?
It's a very good question. It has to do with something called scope. So what scope means is the area that that variable is accessible. So at the very top, we have those four variables and made them public. They're technically accessible anywhere. Anywhere inside this class, even if the public wasn't here, we could access these and change them and do what we wanted. But inside the start where we have this p equals zero, say an update, we're like, okay, what's the value of p? It doesn't work because it is inside this method, meaning it's scoped within this method. P doesn't actually exist for update.
One way to think about scope is to look where the curly bracket pairs are, right? So like everything, like Devin actually has those curly brackets sort of highlighted there. The first one there is the beginning of the start method, and then the one down there is the end of it. And so any variable declared here is only accessible inside that method.
And an important point is it's just scope within the method. You won't have individual scope within this while. So say I'm like int t equals zero.
Who does it?
I don't know.
In ActionScript, it doesn't. So maybe.
Oh, I think that's one of those bugs.
The bugs
works in Flash.
It will blow up. Yeah, because of that. Yeah. But yeah, it's generally not good practice to try to declare types variables inside methods in the middle. And it's good to try to do them at the start. Generally, if you're doing that, your method is doing too much. And I'll explain how to break things out in a little bit. But yeah, to answer your question a little bit more clearly, it just makes it so there's not a lot of stuff going on. If you declared that P there, and then you're like later you have an N in here, and you have all this stuff, your method gets really crowded, and then it kind of lends itself to mistakes, like you thought you declared N, and you're accessing N from a different method. So if you don't need access to a variable outside of that method, don't put it outside of it. Just make sure it's inside. You'll kind of, it's one of those things that as you program and you come across, you're like, oh, I'm gonna put everything in public, you'll eventually start coming across the reasons why. It's this kind of natural thing. You'll all of a sudden run across, why is this not working? Then you're like, oh, I made this mistake because of this. And then you'll kind of, it kind of moves you towards doing it this way. But yeah, don't worry about it too much, but that's kind of the overview. All right. So at the start I went over a few variables. These are not close to how many there actually is. Because technically they're kind of as many as you want. One of the ones we're going to talk about first is enum. So this is something that I wish existed in ActionScript, but it doesn't. So we're going to type public. I just went and cleared out, I should actually clear out everything. Clear out that start, clear out the very top, or right back to the start. So if you fell behind at some point, you're too scared to say, I fell behind, right back to the very start again. So we're gonna go public, and we're gonna type enum. And we're gonna type, create a variable, and we're gonna call it vehicles. So normally you'd notice that I was typing lowercase variable names. So when I was like public, int, I was like, num. You notice that num started with a lowercase. When you're creating variables like this, you always want to start with a lowercase. It's just kind of one of those good practices. And then after, if you're like numb to sky, I don't know. Sky and house. What's the next word going to be? It's going to pop out of my head. So yeah, just something called upper countcase. So whenever you have a space, you just put an uppercase letter. And it always starts with a lowercase. So this public num, it's not. It acts more like a class. So you notice the classes always start with uppercase. So that's kind of how you tell. This num, enum is kind of special. It just acts a little bit like a class. So we're going to go vehicles, and we're going to go open curly bracket. So once again, like the class, once you've created a class here, it has an open curly bracket. And in here, we're just going to declare some different types of vehicles. Car, comma, truck,
boat.
I'm trying to make this really hard for you to make a noise for. No, I'm not going to. It's gonna take
a battlefield. Okay. So Alright. So I've created all these types of vehicles. And then I just close that. Alright, so now what we're gonna do is we're actually going to declare the variable of type vehicle. So we're gonna go public. And you'll notice that now in IntelliSense, there's vehicles. So we created this vehicles. And we're going to name the variable my ride. So my ride is going to be a vehicle. So one of those three vehicles.
But which one?
So now in start here, we're going to go if my ride double equals, because you want to say it's exactly vehicles dot, and then when you hit a dot, it'll come up with the three different types of vehicles that we said. Boat, close round bracket. And now in here, we're gonna go debug.log, I'm on a boat. All right, so then, now when we, has everybody got that? Almost. So as you notice here, we didn't actually declare what my ride is here. So what it'll do by default is it'll actually set it to the very first enum. In this case, car. So this is something that's kind of cool. So now let's go in here and click code. And you'll notice in here we have my ride. And it says car, because that's the first item in that list, the default. Now click on these drop-downs here, and you'll notice it comes up, and it gives the ability to pick these different types. So let's click on boat, and now it should say, I'm on a boat. Kurt? You just look really focused. So.
No, I'm trying to find my spelling mistakes every single time I hit the freaking button.
So I just commented out the public ink and the float stuff that we made earlier, but when I go click on code, they're all still there.
Are they green within the editor?
No, they're blue on my one. They're commented out. But
so is there double? There. Is it double slash? Which way?
I did the slash star and then the star slash.
Are you gonna take? I'm just gonna take a look here.
Like click the.
I think you have a compile error down there, and that's probably why it doesn't update.
Oh yeah, that's another thing. All of a sudden you're like, I changed something, it's not happening. Check to see if you have a compile error. See if at the very bottom here, is something red, and click on it. Because you'll change something and you ended up breaking it a little bit earlier.
Can you bring that back up?
You said before it runs the previous line.
Sometimes, yeah.
Normally, for most lines, you get something.
Generally, when you hit play, though, it won't let you play. It'll say that there's an error. So you don't have to worry about weird stuff like that.
The only reason it's still there is because the script has an error in it, but hasn't like updated it yet, so it's just...
Alright. Has everybody else got that? Okay. We're gonna move on to something, an array. So we're just gonna just clear this stuff all out here. Again.
So is the enum actually a variable, or is that like some kind of class? Or
the actual, at the... Yeah, this enum here, this isn't a variable, this acts as a class. It's kind of this special little class thing, yeah. It's kind of the same if you imagine you created a class, and in it you just had three types inside of it, so it's just kind of a short form for doing that. The actual variable is this line here. Yeah, is that view type vehicles? Yes.
Oh, yeah.
All right, so let's move on to arrays here. So what we're going to do is we're going to take create a variable here called public, and we're going to type string. But instead of then going and creating the variable, here we're going to go open square bracket, close square bracket, and that is just going to create an array of type strings. So an array is just a list of items of that type. So we're going to take friends, names. So all my friends are going to go in here. It's going to be a very short list. all right. So now that you've got that, we're going to go back to Unity. Click on code. And you'll notice that there is a friend's name thing here with a little drop down. If it's not drop down already, click it. And it'll say size 0. So what you can do here
friends.
is change this to the number of friends you have. I'm going to change it to 2. I have 2 friends.
That's a good start.
So it'll come up with 2 elements here. I'm going to my first friend is Bob, and my second friend is Cindy. And so you can end up creating lists here. One word of warning is there isn't really a wonderful way of rearranging things in here. So don't get too crazy and create these massively long lists, but maintaining them in that view will be a little bit challenging.
Would it be in a bad sense to create a list in code instead of in that?
You can create code, or you could create you could put them in, say, an XML file if you had something really long that you just load in and stuff like that. But yeah, sometimes I just create quick lists and actually code. But for things like this that order doesn't matter, this works great. Alright, so now we're going to go back and say we want to print out what those guys are. So we're going to reuse our knowledge in a for loop and just type almost the exact same thing. So for int n equals 0, by n, before we had n is less than 5. In this case, we're going to go n is less than friends' names dot length. I guess I can zoom out here a little bit. Dot length, oops. N plus plus. So almost exactly the same, except instead of a 5 there, we have a friends' name dot length. So that's just how many items are in that array. So in here we're just going to go debug.log, and now we want to get print out each of those friends' names. So we can do that by going to friends' names, and now we're going to go open square bracket, and we're going to pass in the value of n. So what this is doing is at item, in this case the first time you run this through, n is going to be 0. Get the 0 entry in that array. In C#, all lists and things like that start with 0. So it's not like I want the first item, I want to pass 1 in. It's actually you put the first item, you pass 0 in. And we just run that. And click this. And you notice it'll say Bob and Cindy. And while it's not that important for you to know right at this point, there is lots of shortcuts you'll notice as you kind of get used to things. You don't have to worry too much about them right now. There's actually a shortcut for doing that. There's actually even a shorter cut than this, but this is a shortcut.
For each.
For each. So we're gonna say for each string of name in friend's names.
And oh, it's so beautiful.
It is so nice. So what this does is it loops through the array. For each is used for looping through arrays. Friend's names, for every string in that friend's names, and in my case, I put two of them, it sets each one to name as it loops through and then just does that. So it avoids all this typing. Makes that kind of really quick. Okay, I've got three more. So what we're gonna do next is talk about variables. Special variables that come with mono behavior. So let's just nuke this out of here. And in the update here, we're just gonna type transform. This is a special variable. There's a couple of these, and they just give you quick access to things that are components. So I said, for example, here, there was this transform that you've attached here. This would give access to that. So what we're gonna do is just go in here and nuke code, just delete it. Hit the delete key on code. And now go game object, create other, and create a cube. Perfect, we have a cube. So just go in here and in the positions, just make sure you set these to zero, the X, Y, and Z to zero. And you'll notice here we have a cube. Everybody got that?
Nope.
What was the code that you wrote again?
I'll switch back to that in a second. Right. Once you got that, we'll just go back to the code here. And so by typing transform, it's one of those special variables. We go dot, now we can do things to that transform. And one thing we're gonna do is translate. Translate is just a fancy word for move. And so we're gonna move it on its x-axis, one. So we go one, and I don't wanna move it on the y, I don't wanna move it on the z. So once you've got that line there, we hit play.
And nothing happened.
All right, because we created this cube and we didn't attach our script to it. So now attach that script to there and hit play. And you notice that cube just blasted off the screen. So fast. And so say we're like, we don't want it to move at that speed. Now we can utilize some of our knowledge about those public variables. And we go public float speed. And we're going to go speed equals, we're not even going to set speed anything. And now instead of one, we're just going to pass speed in. All right? So now when you go back to the editor, you'll notice speed is here. And we're just going to set this to 0.1. And now when we hit play, you notice it moves really slow. So this allows us to do, as we were was mentioned before, was attaching scripts to multiple objects. Now we created a script that moves an object, any object, along its x-axis, and we can attach the same script to multiple ones and set them to different speeds.
Can you bring up the monitor box in
that? Yep, for sure.
I just had a last thing. It was interesting covering this how to talk to each
Okay. Yes, exactly. Alright. So transform has lots of these different things. We have rotation, that's the other one. So we could rotate it by speed. And then that would just rotate it around the x-axis, the value of speed. and we hit play, and it rotates as it moves. All right, so that's the basic intro to C#. We're going to throw it over to Alec here, and he's going to actually get you to build a game.
Games.
And then you have stuff. Does everyone already have a project file, like the Unity package file?
I still need.
Okay. I'm missing two USB sticks, if somebody has one. Okay.
And there are files that you have? What do you have?
We're handing out project files.
I can just write a little
bit.
Actually, you
can write a little. So if during Alex's presentation, if you have a question, fire your hand up or yell at me and I can run over.
Jose, do you have any of the number one cheat sheets?
I don't have any of the number ones with me, but this is mostly the same as the one we had last time. The whole first part is just tips about how to use the editor. On the back, there's information about how to import a package, which is the first step that we're going to do there. And there's also links to contact info for people and other stuff.
That's what it's doing. It's translating on
it
builds like x-axis.
That's what you about.
So that might be your line.
So if I take this off.
Yeah. Then it should just shouldn't be moving. Yeah. That's the reason.
So I'll try to get it.
Is anybody else in the finals?
I'd like a paper. I'm not sure if I should have a paper or not.
Okay.
Yeah.
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 Same as the first one? The same as the first one? Is this the same cheat sheet as the first one?
It's almost the same. There's some slight differences.
You know.
So if I get your attention for a sec, there's some cool stuff to get through. We're going to talk about making games. Oh yeah, making games. Woo! Okay. We're running an event. The event is the weekend of February 3rd.
Next weekend.
If you're interested in indie games or game development at all, you will want to come to this event. It also, you will get a cool t-shirt. That's pretty neat. Okay, can we take that? Okay, all right. We're going to have a special screening of Indie Game the Movie, which is a film that was made locally by two Winnipeggers. It's about the indie game scene. So we've actually booked CinemaTag on Sunday afternoon at 4. So if you come to this jam, you can come to that screening as well. James and Lizanne will be there. A bunch of people from around North America are flying in, some really talented indie game developers. So it should be a kind of cool thing. It's happening at Skull Space, which is a hacker space that's right near So if you're interested in this, this address is actually on the little papers I handed out on the back page. We don't have a very nice URL, but you can just go to the TickSource forums, which are big indie game community forums, and go to the get-togethers sub-forum, and then there's going to be a thread there for PageEd. And you can get the information there. Or you can tweet at me or Devin or whoever to get the info if you're interested in that. So let's make four games. Or one game. So we're not going to make an MMO. We're going to make a really simple platform. And we're going to use art assets from a game that I'm working on with a guy in Brazil. He's a pretty cool 3D artist. He might actually be flying into the city next month, so if we do a web meeting, hopefully I can bring him in. But we don't know if he's going to be able to get a visa or not to come here. But he generously gave us some of the assets from the game that you guys can use to build this platformer. So that's what that package that I was giving you earlier was all about. So make sure you've created a completely new project from scratch here. And to import the package, there's this assets menu, import package, custom package. And probably most of you have done this already if you've been sitting around here. If this is the right one. Okay, so also the layout I'm using here is 2x3, and I'm probably going to modify it a bit. You can go up in the upper right hand corner and see all the different layouts, and you can select 2x3 so it looks sort of the same. I'm going to drag my project down here so I can get both of these windows up. And so if you look in the project, now you have a bunch of different assets. For example, this little character here. And we're going to use this character to actually animate him, have him run around a little world, stuff like that. But I think the first thing we should start with here is maybe just building a level, because that's what we did last time. So if you open up the prefabs folder here, you'll see you have all these different types of blocks that you can use. And to just get started really basically, this is kind of like Minecraft or something. You just drag this into the scene view or into the hierarchy. Make sure it's at 000 to just make your life easier. So basically, I've just dragged this block cube out of the project folder into the hierarchy, so now it's in the world somewhere. You can
what
hit.
If I drag into that tab, it just snaps back.
What window are you dragging it into?
Yeah, mine went all weird, and now they're all pink.
Yeah.
Did that happen to everybody?
Yeah, there's no materials applied, and. It looks like the model that was associated is gone.
Oh, that's great.
I had them before, like all the wood grain ramps and
Did you guys just import
maybe,
the package?
Re-import.
Yeah,
I'm just gonna re-import here.
That's
gonna open up the new
you can just you have all the models in that folder. You can just show people how to drag the models over, right? Or you have scripts and stuff.
I don't have any scripts, I just have models.
So you should be able to use the models themselves.
Okay, so what's happening is I've created a Unity package in a version of Unity that is newer than what some of you have. So you aren't able to import files now.
Yeah.
What do I do?
Okay, so which prefab do you want to drag over?
I want to be able to use all these prefabs, and maybe there's a way I can throw onto a USB stick just the files.
Well, do you have really complicated things on these things? Like, could you
just
get people
to the blocks before? It was under models.
Yeah, like, you can see by, just by dragging the model.
Yeah. So, like, if you take this MVQ,
it's going to be really just the
and then try to drag it onto block Q.
I just closed the project and opened up the new project. I got them working just by closing and opening up a new project and dragging the assets back.
Do you want version in Unity?
So dragging the assets just in from the.
No, I loaded them the same way you showed them. Same Word package, custom Unity package. But,
can you go to help?
What do you guys with the older version see when you just drag the kid model into the same?
The kid comes in.
Is he there? Is he attached to you?
Yeah, the model.
Yeah. Like, do you see that?
Yeah.
Attached
to
We could just make new prefabs.
Yeah, I mean, if you guys want to, basically what you can do, since you have all the models here, the models for the blocks are in the models folder, proto blocks. So here's just the model for the cube you can drag in, and then to actually give it a texture, all you have to do is find the material, wherever the heck that is. Probably somewhere in here, yeah. S block wood. Drag that on. So it's not really that complicated to recreate that. It's a little bit tedious. But we can block out a really, really basic level with just one block. You can even use a default Unity cube if you want. We'll have to see what happens when we get to animations. That'll be fun. See if those actually work or not.
When I drag the kid that runs into the screen and push play, like it shows him running.
Okay, cool. So we might be good then. So basically all I'm doing here is I've got some kind of cube prefab or whatever the heck you can scrounge up. And it doesn't really matter as long as it's solid and you can hit it. Right, if you're just dragging models in, they may not be solid. So actually, let's all do this instead of making a pretty level. Let's just make an ugly prototype level. And what we can do here is just go to game object, create other cube. So this will just create the default boring old gray cube. And you can just clone that one instead. So it's solid by default. You can just start building a little.
Do you want this in a 2D perspective?
Yeah, so it's really helpful. Because basically what we're going to be doing is building a little side-scroller platformer. And it's using 3D models, but really the gameplay is just going to go left and right. So to make it easier to edit, you can use this gizmo over here and just click these different things to get into the view called back. Back is the view that you want. And to duplicate things, you can basically hold down Control and hit D or Command D on a Mac.
How are you snapping it to?
To snap, you hold Control or Command here on Mac, and then just drag. You can change your snap settings in the edit menu snap settings, but probably your default snap settings will be okay. So basically, we're just going to set up something so that we have an area for the player to run around in.
When you click on the box, like on the X, Y, or Z, and you get in that perspective, how do you get it so that the item is in the center of the screen?
So one way to get the camera back, if you're sort of like say my camera was way over here and I'm like looking at nothing, I have no idea where the camera is or anything, I can go select something in the hierarchy, move my cursor over here, and then hit the F key, and it'll warp the camera to that object. Then you can sort of scroll out and get back to where you are. So you can kind of move around. There's some other hints on this, on these sheets as well about how to navigate. So one thing that will happen, if you didn't start your first cube off at 000, all your snaps are going to be relative to where you started. So you really want to start at 000, because every time you move with a snap, it's going to just move one unit from that. So if you started, say this half-size cube was at 7.2, and I use snap to the right, it's going to go to 8.2. Right? So if you're kind of off the grid, you need to go back into here, edit these values to get back onto it.
And how would I move a whole bunch of them? So that first one is at 00. I tried parenting them, but it's at a...
You want to move a bunch of them to do to
get so that the first one is set to 0-0.
I don't know if there's an easy way to do that. You might have to just slide a whole group over. You can group select by doing this. You can
slide over there. Yeah, but then your pound number is sort of in the middle of your selection, not necessarily in the middle of a queue.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't know if there's a way to determine which one is going to be the main target there. Okay, so if you have some kind of collection of blocks floating around, that's good enough. We just need something that the player can collide with when he falls down. So I'm going to start building the player. And we're going to start building him here. If your first cube's at 0, 0, 0, we're going to build him at 0, 0.50. So what I've done is I've created a new empty game object. It's just game object create empty. And I like starting with an empty because it gives you a bit more organization. It's just like a point in 3D space. You can stick anything you want into it as a child object. So eventually what we're going to do is we're going to attach this player model to this empty object and move the empty around the player will fall with. So we can rename this object to player. Just up here. We're going to want to give him a tag. You don't really need to know what this is yet, but it'll become important later. And there's already a tag set up by default and it'll be called player. This is just a way of identifying what this type of object is, because later on we may want to detect, oh, is the player standing on this switch, or is something else standing on the switch? So we just have this little empty thing. It's called player, it's tagged player, it's at 0, 0.50. Now we're gonna drag the kit model into the scene. We're going to just drag it right on top of the player. And so there he is.
Sorry, which kid was it?
Just kid with nothing. So these models are actually animations in separate files. And after the at symbol is the name of the animation. So if you actually play this right now, you should be able to see the kid animate. I think he has a little eyelid by default. Yeah, he's looking around. Yeah. If you have a crash, I'm sorry. We could try doing this project again with the right version numbers. And if your thing is crashing, you can just follow along here to see how this stuff works. So is everyone sort of at that point, or we're crashing?
Good. We were at that point.
Before you crashed?
Yeah.
Okay. That's awesome. That's unfortunate, though. We're a soldier on.
Can we just use a cube?
Sure, yeah. If you have some kind of crash issue, you could throw anything in there. Anything that's visible. So I'll just show you what that would look like. We create another cube here. I'm going to rename the player cube, just so I can see what it is in here. Attach it to the player, make sure it's at 0. So now if I move this player empty around, there's a cube moving around the side of it. I'm going to subtract the player here. So just a really, really simple way of getting this dude to move. Just to get us started here. And I don't know how much time we'll have to get down to actually getting him to move properly or well, but we will start the complete basics here. So in the scripts folder, you can right-click it, go to create and C# script. So just like Devin was showing you before, this is just making a new script. We're gonna call it player. And this is going to be basically the brain of the player. This is what is going to make the player move and perform actions, stuff like that. You double-click that, load it up in model develop.
Do you want to delete?
So you can clear everything out and just set up this empty update function, or you can just modify the one that's there. I'm really picky about where my curly braces go, so that's why I always delete what's there, because I don't like having the curly brace over here.
Yeah.
Damn right. Yes.
I didn't do that, but I love that.
You really love it.
So this is basically where the guts of what the player's going to do is going to happen, because update gets called every frame. If you're running a game at 60 frames per second, this update function is getting called 60 times a second. And in here you can do various different things. You can play animations, you can change the player's position, you could play sound effects. So we're going to just replicate what Devin was doing. We're going to use this basic translate function. And we're just going to do this thing. So he set that up. We already know that would move him to the right really, really quickly, which we don't want. We want to be able to customize the speed, so we can say that we're going to make a speed variable here. We haven't actually defined it yet, but we're just sort of mocking this up. And one thing we're going to add that Devin didn't have in there is this voodoo here, time.deltaTime. We're going to multiply that. And basically what that does is it makes it so that this will run at the same speed on any computer, even if the computer is running at 30 frames per second or 60 or 120. Basically, it's just adjusting the speed by the amount of time that has passed since the last frame. You don't really need to understand it too much. You just need to know that you need to multiply it by it for now. And then so up here, we're just going to do the same thing that Devin was doing with a public float speed.
Of course, no, if you multiply it, if you just have delta time in there instead of speed, or you multiply it by one, it'll move 1 meter a second.
So, if we're all at that point where we just have this sort of basic script, we just have a float variable for speed, and every time we update, we're going to move to the right by speed times delta time, and we need to make sure to drag the script onto the player here. And the speed is zero, so it won't be going very fast. We can set it to maybe, I don't know, four. I'm not sure what to get. So that's kind of fast. Two. Okay, so two looks like a kind of okay, maybe walking speed. So is everyone at that point? Are there any errors or questions?
It's much more like the pending telescope for transport. So if you're playing, you can add it.
Sometimes mono develops just messes up. So sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. Because mono develops is kind of funny. Like
that.
If you're in Telesense, it disappears.
Yeah, just mono develops.
Sometimes you have to resync your project too.
I literally just ran into
that. Nice.
I assumed it was a feature.
So basically, this is like the lamest way to move anything. And sometimes it's actually useful to move things. Like if we were making a menu system and we just wanted this menu item to go flying off the screen or something like that, we could use something like this. But if we look at what happens when we have an obstruction in the way, he just goes right through it. Does not give a single fuck. He just goes right through it. So we're going to have to do something a bit more complicated to get him to actually stop. So we're going to have to add something to the player here. We're going to select the player. We're going to go to component menu here. All the way down to physics. And character controller. Now there are a bunch of different ways to actually make characters move and interact in levels. This is one of them. This is kind of what you would generally want to do if you're making a 2D platformer, but there are some exceptions. So we just add that. And now you'll see that this green capsule will appear around the player. And this capsule is actually like way too big right now. Like he's just inside this giant pill or something. And if your game is about that,
onto the player somewhere?
Yeah?
You drag that onto the player? Like how is that associated with the player?
Okay, so let me remove it again. So like I was, you have this component menu. If the player selected, you go up to the component menu, you go to physics, and go to character controller. And you just click, and that will add that component. And so you can see it's on this list of all this junk that's on the player. So there's the player script and a transform and this character. So we're just going to resize this thing here so it's maybe a bit more. You can actually just drag left and right on these to resize to fit the player model that you have. And you kind of want to make sure there's a little bit of space between here. Because the character controller has sort of extra padding around it.
So how do you select that?
Basically, you're just selecting the player.
Yeah.
And you're just going in here and tweaking these different character controller values.
Oh,
so,
okay.
For example, the center Y position of this capsule, setting it to 0.5. Radius is about 0.2, maybe. Height maybe 0.95. Lower the skin width, and we'll see. We kind of have to just tweak these things, play with them, move the character out a bit, go back, tweak them.
So that's the actual collision box?
Yeah, this is the collision capsule. So basically it's like a rounded thingy hill, basically. So now we're going to do some booting. Because what we want to do is we want to get access to that character controller component from inside this code. We can see it's attached to this object here. We need to get at it through the code now. And we need to call some methods on it. We need to make it do some stuff for us. So we're going to create a new variable, and the type is going to be character controller. So instead of being a float or an int, it's something way more exciting. And we're going to call it character controller with three L's. two L's, okay. So it's important to note the uppercase, lowercase stuff here. Because we have an uppercase character controller for the type, and then we're just making character controller lowercase. We can call this whatever we want. We can call it Frank. But we will call it character controller because that's what it is. And so instead of calling this, we are going to use this move function. Now this move function takes a vector 3. It's not the same as this, but it is similar. So what we're going to write here is we're going to put in a vector 3.right. What does that mean? Well, vectors are basically directions. Basically ways of indicating directions or positions in 3D space. And this is just a predefined thing that we can get at that means the right. And we're just going to multiply that by speed and by time. Delta time.
Is vector 3 always relative to the camera?
No, in this case, this is relative to the world. So it's like the world right. If you wanted it to be relative to something, you could put in a transform, so camera.main.transform would actually get you the camera's right vector. So vectors are really cool for doing kind of tricky orientation stuff. But in this case, we're just using it to basically say, go that way. So we can try running that, see if it actually works. No, it doesn't, because we set up this private variable, and we didn't set it to. Right now, it's just nothing. It's null. It hasn't been set. It's a reference to a character controller that has not been set. It doesn't know what character controller we're talking about, basically. So we need to tell it in, let's say, awake.
So as I mentioned before, awake is just before start.
Yeah, it'll get called before start. And so this is generally where you would do stuff like this. You're just basically doing some setup work. We just wanted to tell it, hey, here's what your character controller is. And we're going to get the component. So this is a function you'll use a bunch to get references to components that are attached to your object. And we're going to introduce this less than sign here. There are a few different ways to write this function, but this is the one I prefer. So this is used to specify the type of component we want to get. And then we just do normal brackets, open, close, and semicolon. So the syntax there is a little weird. Now, just to show you, you could also write it like this. But you would have to then do this, which is a pain in the butt. So we'll just do that. So if we've all got that, then hopefully now if we go back and run it, it should assign that character control and he actually moves and hits the wall, yay, and stops.
So how does it know to get that particular character?
Basically, what we're doing here is similar to writing this. So it's getting it from the current mono behavior. And right now there's only one character controller on it, so it just gets that one. If you had multiple ones, I don't know what would happen. But I think there's a way to get multiple.
You can get multiple ones. And so it's whatever, so just imagine the script that you're writing that in, when you do that, it's game object, so whatever it's attached to, and then it just goes through every component looking for that particular one. So if there isn't one, then it would just return a nothing, right? But in this case, there is one. And if you had multiple ones, it would return the first one, but then there's also a thing that will list them all for you.
So what it's doing is it's assuming your target for the Git controller is the object that the script is applied to, but you could in script target another object
and
target
it. And that's where it gets kind of cool.
Because
you could have some other object called, I don't know what, called Devin. Let's say that this is Devin. Okay, he looks the same as his other kid except he's taller. So you could reference that character controller instead and have something control this other object. But we won't do that right now. It's too complicated. Okay, so if we all got to this point, we have the character and he hits a block and gets stopped. If you have a block in your scene, I don't know what your scene looks like. But you might want to put a block there just to make sure he actually collides with stuff.
Mine walks right through the block. Is that because I didn't use your prefab block? And then is there some kind of physics associated with the other blocks that I didn't?
Oh, yeah. If you have the prefab and it's broken, there may not be physics on it. What you can try doing is just using the default Unity cube and see if that stops him or not.
Yeah, that's the same thing that happened with me. I was using those ones.
Okay, so for now, for your level, you want to use Unity's default cube because we're having problems with our gliders. They may not be solid, so the player might be walking right through them.
So when I push play, my character starts moving. It looks like he jumps up a little bit.
Yeah, so if your character pops up a bit, that's because the bottom of his capsule glider is hitting the ground. So if I adjust the height here a bit, I think I might get that effect too. He's moving a bit too far. Let me just slow him down here. So you're basically seeing that kind of effect where he just pops out of the ground, which is good because sometimes if he's wedged too far in the ground, he'll just fall through it. So you want to make sure he starts sort of above the ground, basically. That's why I made this like a little bit smaller there.
Yeah, there's this.
Why did my skin width go to 0.000? The skin width is kind of like a little bit of extra padding. Sort of like how much he's going to float above the ground. So that's another parameter you can play around with in these settings here to tweak them. So if we head back to the script for a second. So we have him moving to the right automatically. And now we want to actually hook up some input so that the player can actually control how this guy is moving, right? And this is actually not too hard to do. So pretty much anywhere in this big stream of multiplications, we can add another thing to multiply. And we can say input dot get axis raw. So exciting. Horizontal in quotes. So we're basically just adding this into this mix. And this is going to give you a negative one all the way to one floating point value. So This is something that's set up in Unity's preferences. You can tweak these things and give them any name you want and all that stuff. We have a bunch of things set up by default. And one is called the horizontal axis. And basically this gets input from the keyboard, from the arrow, left and right arrow keys. It also gets A and D arrow or keys, I guess. It also gets input from a joystick. So pretty much automatically now, like you'll be able to move character left and right by plugging in a joystick or using keys.
Should it fall off an edge?
We haven't added gravity, so it shouldn't be falling. So if that actually compiles and runs for you, you should be able to move him left and right. Very slowly if your speed is set to 2.2. You'll notice if you go to the left here, or if you go off wherever your ground is, he'll just float. He won't fall, and that's because we haven't actually told him to fall yet.
Could you pick your screw for
something? Do what?
Screwed up something.
Oh, sure, yeah. Let me see if I can zoom out a bit.
Should be rigid body physics to get rid of
guys, moving one reason might be because your speed is set to zero by default. And you need to make sure to go into the actual player component and set the speed to some number greater than zero. You can also do funny stuff like set the speed to -2, and then he'll move backwards. Like when you hit left, he'll move right, right, he'll move left.
That's a good way to increase that.
Perfect. So if everyone's got that roughly working, I'm going to start modifying this a little bit, because what we want to do is actually make the player start to sort of fall. So oops. What I'm going to try and do here is just grab this stuff that's in here, because it's starting to get really I don't like how long this is. And fortunately, I have a bunch of options. I can cut this, move it up here, paste it. I'm going to create a new variable that's local to the scope of the update function called move. Set it equal to this jump. Put a semicolon on the end. So basically, all I've done here, I've taken this vector map, I'm stuffing it into this variable, and then I'm passing this variable to this move function. The only reason I'm doing that is just to organize this a bit more. Just so I don't need to see all that in there. I'm just adding a velocity. Now, we're going to use that velocity to track how fast the player is falling. So let's go up here. Okay, so I did a whole bunch of stuff there. I'm creating a private variable that will store our velocity. currently we're only going to use it for downward velocity. We could use it for other things later if we wanted to. Every time we update, and this is going to break the game, by the way. But every time we update, we're going to add to velocity. Velocity plus equals basically means velocity equals velocity plus physics.gravity times delta time. Now this is a Unity thing. You can go into the physics panel and change the gravity. It's set to minus 9.82 or whatever, the default gravity in meters per second, I guess. And this is initializing a new variable called move, setting it to zero, vector 3.0, which basically means three zeros. And then we're just adding these different things to it. We're going to add in this, and I'll actually comment on this to make more sense here. So this line below, that is the player's input. So basically, movement to the right times speed, times the input value we get, and that can negate that, so that can make it to the left or the right, or zero, and times delta time. And then we're adding in the velocity that we're accumulating as gravity pulls down. Now, one of the funny things is we're not ever stopping it. So our velocity is going to get infinitely large, and the player will fall through the ground. But we will fix that later. Or not. Maybe it's an arcane. Okay, so I just want to test if this works. I'll go back to the script in a sec here. So he's actually not warping through the ground, so that's cool. But he is still accumulating velocity as he's sitting there, which doesn't make a lot of sense. Like, while I'm standing on the ground, my velocity is not constantly increasing too. We could actually debug log the velocity. So, you know, this is something you'll use if you run into problems with your code. You can just be like, oh, I'll just print out the velocity. You don't even need this part, you know, necessarily. You could just say debug log velocity if you want to save time, and then you can jump back into here, play it, and just see what his velocity is. Let's take a look. Yeah, it's just going out. No big deal. I kind of want to make the model shake based on the current velocity. So the longer you wait, the more velocity he'll accumulate, and then when you go off the edge, the faster he'll fall. So if I go off like right away, it'll be sort of like reasonable. But if I wait like say like 10 seconds or 5 seconds, we'll see when it gets up to maybe like minus, you know, 60. Whoa.
So mine actually did fall straight to the floor.
Okay.
So.
Devin, you want to see if he has a collider there? They might be a collider or something. Or he might need to just move the player up a bit so he doesn't start to set up. Okay, so one way to fix this is to reset the velocity. So, remember before we were talking about if statements and all the weird, cool stuff you can do with if statements. This is a pretty simple one. It's just, is the character on the ground? If the character is on the ground, do whatever happens in here. And you can put an else down here. If he's not on the ground, do something else. So, actually, let's move this because
makes more sense to me. Put this, just gonna cut it and add it here, under this thing. So this is a little hacky, but basically I'm just gonna set the velocity, the y part of it, because right now we only care about up and down and that's the y-axis. I'm just gonna set it to some constant value. Right now I just picked -3 because I already did this and I know that value works. But I mean, you could also put in a variable, set that variable up top, play around with it, if you didn't know what value you wanted in advance. So, but this is just gonna basically say, when you're on the ground, your velocity is always gonna be this. We want to set it to something that's not zero, because when you start going down a slope, the player might sort of go slightly off the slope before falling down. If his velocity is zero, then he has to add up again every time. So this will enforce it, so he'll actually go down a slope sort of more smoothly. So we can actually try that, even if all we have are cubes. We can just grab this cube, rotate it, just sort of shove it in here. Make a really ugly kind of mock-up. You even just take like one sort of cube and stretch it out and rotate it a little bit. I'm not really sure what's gonna happen, so let's find out. That's sort of reasonable. You can go up and down the slope. He's not really like hopping too much. So now we can add jumping. So is everyone sort of caught up roughly to this point? No? any specific questions that I go over? Or yeah. I'm gonna keep going on this. Ask Devin if you need some hands-on help. So basically what we wanna do for a jump, basically we're gonna wait for some kind of input. And Unity comes with a jump key already defined. So we can use another function from the input class here called getButtonDown. Now there is getButtonDown, getButtonUp, and just getButton. GetButtonDown means this will only be true the first time a button goes down. So like this is like the moment when the player has pressed the jump key. The jump key, by the way, is space by default. If this was get button, it would return true while you were holding the button down. So every frame, if you're holding it down, true, 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 true. This one's only true in the first frame the button goes down. That's what we want. You just want to be like push button down, then do jump. And this is called jump in double quotes there. So again, we're just using an if statement. We're just like, if this is happening, then do whatever we want. And we just want to basically set our y velocity to jump power. And what's jump power? It's a variable that we're going to make up here. So all we've done, we've made a new floating point value called jump power. It's public, so we'll be able to edit it. So we can tweak his jump strength throughout the game. Playtesting would be really useful to do that. You know, maybe when you're playing around with level design, you're like, oh, his jump's not quite high enough, I want to tweak it higher. Oh, it's too high. So that's kind of the cool thing about Unity. You can really easily fiddle with those things. And then basically we're just saying, when you push the jump, we're going to set your velocity upwards to the value jump power. And then gravity will naturally pull the character back down. We don't need to worry about that because we're already adding in this gravity into our current velocity. So the first thing you'll need to do is make sure you actually give it a jump power greater than zero. And I don't know what it's going to need to be here. So we'll just try some stuff. Whoa, moon jumps. So I sort of just want him to jump like one tile high. Five seems like a reasonable number for that.
Yeah, it's not showing up here.
So there's nothing checking to see if you're on the ground. So you can just jump as much as you want. You can just keep tapping it and fly. You can wait a while and like come back down. So I mean, if you wanted to make a game about like a bird, this could be it. Maybe you just tap to flap your wings and move around. Just, yeah. So if you actually aren't making Joust and you want the guy to only be able to jump when he's on the ground, we can employ some of the knowledge that Devin imparted to us. That sounded really eloquent. We're going to do that creepy and symbol that looks freaky, but don't worry, it's your friend. And just check the value of his grounding. So now, basically, this is like, before we just had one condition for this thing to execute, for this jump to actually happen. The only condition was you have to push the jump button down. But now we're also checking to see if you're on the ground. So, should be smooth. See. So now I can't fly anymore.
Go back to the script.
Yep. So basically, what I'm coding right now here is block. What this is going to do is it's going to check to see if the player is pushing the key to the right. If so, it's going to set the forward vector of model. Now, model is something we haven't defined yet, but it's going to be the player model that's inside of that player object, the kid object. Set it to the right. If you're moving to the left, so if your horizontal movement value is negative whatever, set face left. You can also do this by setting angles, but this is kind of an easy way to do it. And the other thing we need to do here, once you have that code, and one way to write this quickly is to just grab this guy and just copy it, you know, and paste it into the thing. Save some time. The other thing we need to add up here is public transform model. And so again, this is like another public variable that we can edit, and it's another reference, and it's going to default to nothing again. And we're going to have to get plug something in here so that it knows what it needs to modify later. So if most of you are caught up on that script change there, if we jump back into here, you see that now we have this model parameter. We can actually, there are a few different ways we can get this thing. We can just drag the kid object into it by doing that. There's also this little button here that will show you everything in the scene. And you can even like search for stuff and do it that way. So you can also search in here. So basically, we just want to assign this thing so it knows what it needs to adjust. And then if we run this, then he faces different directions. And actually, if your game looks like this and it's really zoomed out, you can go into the main camera object and just play with the Z value and maybe get a nicer camera angle. So now he actually changes direction instantly. And he's still just standing there like an idiot as he jumps around.
Can we show the script?
Oh, yes, right. So it's just this. This is a new thing we just added. And we also added a line up top, public transform model. So kind of. And what you can do later, you can get more advanced and actually call something that smoothly rotates the player over time. There's a library you can get to do that. Maybe next time we'll look into that kind of thing. But this is actually not a bad way to start prototyping a game. You might not want to do all those sort of smooth effects right at the beginning, just get the basics of it working. And then this is the other thing up here. And if you forget to assign model, so say this is empty here, you'll get an error when you run the program and try to move. It'll say null reference exception, variable model of player has not been assigned. It'll take you right to the line. That means that here it was trying to set the models forward, but you haven't actually given it a model. So it's like, what am I supposed to do? So if you get null reference exception, that just basically means that you probably have not assigned something. And it actually says that right here. You probably need to assign the model variable to player scheduling inspector, which is exactly what we do here by doing that.
Bring the script back. I copy that.
So I'll just do one other little thing here, and maybe next time we'll look at actually getting the animations to play properly, because that might take a bit too long and we're running over time. But one other thing that's kind of handy to have right now is if I'm playing a game, I'm jumping around, I go off the camera, and I have no idea where I am. So one thing we can write, we can make a new script here. So we're just right-clicking on script, going to create C# script. I'm going to call this one camera follow. And hit enter. And double click. Sure. Let's do that again. Okay, so basically what I've set up here, we have another transform that we're going to reference. We're going to call it target. This is the target object that the camera is going to follow. Okay, so we'll assign that to the player later on in the scene. And actually, let's use a different update function. Let's use late update. So late update is like update, but later.
target, and then transform, is that right?
Yeah. So basically, we're going to copy the target position's x value and its y value, but not its depth value, not its z value, because we want to set that in the camera separately. So say you want the camera to be this far away. If we set it to the player's z, it would be inside the player.
Right.
We wouldn't actually see him. We'd see insides of him. And then we're just setting our current transform position for that. We're going to remember the semicolon, of course. Always drink your semicolon.
And why did you change that to late update?
The reason I changed it to late update is so I can ensure that this has the latest values. There's different ways you can do this, but it basically means that the player will move and update, and then this camera won't bother updating until after that, so that we make sure that we're not lagging behind the player. You can also go into Unity and actually tell it which scripts to run first, but that's sort of a more complicated way of doing it. It might not make a difference currently, but when you start doing things like cameras that are going to follow things smoothly, it becomes a bit more important.
Did you pin that to the player or the camera?
So we're going to pin this onto the camera here. So just drag the script on the camera. And then inside the script there's a target. And we're just going to drag the player onto that. We could drag it onto other things too. So you can imagine a game where maybe you can possess other enemies and switch camera targets and the camera's swooping over or whatever. So this gives you some flexibility to play around. And then if you've done this all right, the camera will just fall in a very sort of basic way. It'll just be sort of blocked to them. And inside the scene view, you can adjust your Z, stuff like that. And it should keep that. And just a very simple modification just to sort of bring home how easy it is to start tweaking things and fine-tuning things in Unity. Like just add a new vector 3 called offset. And then all I need to do, let's make a separate line here because my lines are getting too long. So this is just going to be some extra stuff that we can add to adjust the camera off of where the player's position is. And we can customize that in the editor because it's just a public variable. So, got that, and we can go into here, and now there's a nice little vector 3, and we can be like, okay, I want to go up one unit, run that, and now the camera will be slightly upwards. You can adjust this in here too. And you could do cool things, like you could even change the offset based on how fast the player is moving. So maybe as he starts running, the camera goes a bit more to the right, and then he slows down and comes back, you know.
Or zooms in and out.
You can zoom in and out, yeah. So you can even adjust that as well here by changing the Z value. Whoa. Right, I know why that's happening. So don't change the Z value unless you want to see a really cool zoom out effect. This. Whoa. Okay. I think that's all we have time for.
Z value and doesn't just
yeah, because it's using its old Z value. So it's taking the Z value it was at, adding offset.
Yeah.
It doesn't reset it. So it just keeps adding to it every fight. But anyways, that's all we have time for.
Yeah, I want to talk a little bit about Unity 3.5, but didn't quite have time for it now, but hopefully the next meeting. So for the next meeting, for doing hands-on, I just recommend everybody try to bring their laptop up to 3.5. And so yeah, it's latest and greatest, and it's awesome. So.
Did I see the script?
Oh, sure, yeah.
It's 3.5, right?
Yes.
It's in what's called RC1, so it's just before final release, but it's publicly available to everybody.
Sorry, what did you do to make it when you push play, it doesn't go right, you zoom into the kit?
Okay, so just make sure offset doesn't have a Z value set.
You would have set the
Z value
in the offset. This guy right here.
I think I might be able to.
No, Oh, that's the problem. Target.position.z, change that to transform.position.z. Yeah, that way it's easy to come down. Camera's transform position.
Thanks for everybody for coming out. We're off to the King's Head for a drink. You guys want to join us?
Thank you.
Is there any USBs floating around out there?
Yeah, I think I have four or
something.
We have two.
For halfway there.
Thank you.
Okay.